Hello everyone, this is Manas, your friend and tutor. And guys, let's kickstart with case number 4, which essentially is a combination of case 2 and case 3. That means there are going to be two mutually perpendicular stresses, sigma x, sigma y. Also, it is going to be accompanied with a shear stress. So first of all, let me make a figure of that member and then we'll try to analyze that in all possible scenarios. Here we go. So this exactly over here is this scenario, and what we wish to do is that we want to find the value of normal stress and tangential stress on this plane. Let's say this is E. And by the way, the thickness again has to be taken as unity of 1, right? So let us try to analyze this, and let me make a three-dimensional diagram of this particular small element over here. So here we go. Onto this element, the forces which are going to act, one is over here onto this face, and by the way, this is E, that's B, and that's C onto this face in this direction. You've got this force because of sigma x. So this is going to be Px. Secondly, onto this much area, that is EB area, okay? EB multiplied by one area, you can say. There is a force acting because of sigma y, and this has got to be in the downward direction. Yeah. So this is going to be Py. After this, you've got two shear forces. One shear force acting on this surface EB, okay, on this bottom surface, and the other shear force along this direction. And the directions of both the shear forces will be towards B. Left to right, top to bottom. So one is going to be in this direction. Yeah, that's it. Let's say this is Q2, and one is going to be along this direction in the BC phase. Let's say this is going to be Q1. So these are essentially all the forces acting on this very small element. And by the way, this angle over here has to be taken as theta with respect to this vertical, and we are measuring this in the clockwise sense. How can this be assessed? Here we go. So it's better that we can make the front view of this and then try to analyze it. Here we go. Just watch. What is the force acting in this direction? That is Py. In the horizontal direction, it's Px. In the downward direction, you've got Q1. This is, by the way, Q1. And towards this right hand side, okay, this over here, that is Q2. That is Q2 simply. Now, what we wish to do is, we wish to resolve all of these components along Pn and Pt. So one thing is, you want to find the normal stress across this plane. So for normal stress, you've got to find the value of Pn, and for tangential stress, you've got to find the value of Pt. So Pn will be along this direction. Yeah, that's Pn, and Pt will be along this direction, along the plane. Normal is perpendicular to the plane. That's it. Simple funda. That's Pt for you. How can you do that? Again, this is going to be fairly simple. And if you watch carefully, this angle made over here, this is going to be theta. If that is the case, this also is going to be theta. If that is theta, then this is going to be theta. And this is the component of Px along Pn. And then this is the component of Px perpendicular to Pn. So if you just try to write them up, this is Px and theta. So this is going to be Px cosine theta. And simply this is going to be Px sine theta. That's it. Secondly, you got this Py. So Py is, watch this. One component will be here, and the other component will be in this direction. That's for sure. This vertical inclined. Vertical inclined. This angle will obviously be equal to theta. So if you watch carefully, this is Py, and this is going to be Py cos theta. Py cos theta. And this is going to be Py sin theta. Okay, so Px and Py done. We need to resolve Q1 and Q2. So Q1 will have a component over here and one over here. So Q1's component in this direction is going to be Q1 cosine theta. Q1 cosine theta. And in this direction, this is going to be Q1 sin theta. Done. Q2 will have two components again. one along this direction, and by the way, let me just erase this E, and this is going to be what? Okay, let me see. This is going to be Q2 cos theta, and along this direction, this is Q2 sin theta. So we've got everything worked out. We just need to punch in the value in the formula, and you are going to immediately get the value of normal stress. That can be done fairly easy. This is what we are going to use. Normal stress. Normal stress is equal to what? Pn over normal stress across which area? This area. This area. Ec multiplied by, and this has to be taken as unity, as I told you, 1. Okay, and this is going to be how much? E, where is it? Ec multiplied by 1, that is the area. Ec multiplied by 1, done. Now guys, individually we need to work out the value of all these forces. So if you just take a careful look, this Px is equal to stress sigma x multiplied by area. Which area? This one, the side one. So BC multiplied by 1 is going to give you BC, simply dot BC. In the same manner, you can calculate the value of PY. PY will be equal to sigma y, okay, and this bottom surface, that is EB multiplied by 1, that is EB. In the same manner, you can work out Q1, and Q1 is acting on this side surface. So Q1 is going to be equal to shear stress along this surface, that is BC surface, that is tau, by the way, this is tau, multiplied by this BC into 1. So obviously it is BC, and similarly Q2 will be equal to tau times of EB into 1, tau times of EB. So we now know all the forces in terms of their stresses acting on the respective surfaces. You need to write down all the components along with their directions. You need to write down all the components of Px, Py, Q1 and Q2 along Pn. So we are going to start off with Px. So Px is along Pn. Okay, this is positive, and in this direction it will be negative. Px sin theta, then plus Py sin theta. Okay, after that plus that's not Px sin theta. Instead, this should be Px cos theta plus Py sin theta. Let me write this. Px cos theta plus Py sin theta. Apart from that, you've got Q1 and Q1, that is Q1 sin theta and Q2 cos theta. Done. Once again, this is Q1 sin theta and this is Q2 cos theta. And all of these force components divided by the area. Area of this plane, that is EC multiplied by 1, that is EC. What you now need to do is, you need to punch in the value of Px, Py, Q1 and Q2. Okay, and then you need to simplify. Time to go into flashback. If you just take a careful look, this is exactly the same expression which we had earlier got in case 2. Exactly the same expression. And this over here is again exactly the same expression which we had got in case 3. Okay, so we are going to be, I'm not going to go ahead and solve all of this stuff. You know the deal. What I'll try to do is, I'll write the most simplified form. When you try to solve this, when you simplify this, when you punch in BC over EC, this BC over EC as cos theta, and then EB over EC as sin theta, when you do all of that, you do the simplification, the final value which you are going to get is this. So that's it. This is the final expression, and this over here represents case 2, and this is simply case 3. That's it. This is subjected to two mutually perpendicular stresses, and this is subjected to pure shear. Okay. In the same manner, we can also work out the value of tangential stress across this plane, and that can be done very easily using this formula, sigma t. Sigma t is nothing but Pt over area. How much is the area? That is EC. EC should have written E over here multiplied by 1. So you simply write EC. Okay. Now try to work out all the forces in the direction of PT. Let us start from the component of PX. PX, where are we? Here, PX. Okay, this is in the direction of PT. So PX sin theta positive. What about PY? PY, this is in the opposite direction. So negative, minus PY cos theta. What about Q1? Q1, this is also in the opposite direction, downward direction. So this is going to be minus Q1 cos theta. And this Q2, Q2 sin theta is over here. So this is positive and this is negative. So Q2 sin theta minus Q1 cos theta. It's going to get very easy now. PX, you know, just need to punch in all these values. So let's try to do that first of all. Again, the same stuff. If you take a look over this mathematical expression, this is exactly the same that we had got in case 2. And if you take a look at this expression over here, this is exactly the same as the one that we'd got in case 3. Exactly. And this final result, let me just make a check. There are a lot of formulas in this. This is going to work out as sigma x minus sigma y by 2 sine 2 theta. Okay. So this is exactly how you can get the value of sigma n and sigma t, right? Following the simple laws of mechanics. So guys, let us take this session forward, and now we are interested in calculating the values of theta, which would give you the planes of maximum principal stress, that is sigma major and sigma minor, or the planes where shear stress is zero. We also are interested in calculating the value of maximum shear stress, okay, and at what angle that happens. So all of that and much more coming up. Here we go. Okay, so first of all, let me just write the two formulas which we had just derived. One was perpendicular to this plane, that was represented by sigma n. Okay, that's sigma n. And one was tangential, sort of. This is represented by sigma t. So let me first of all write these two formulas, and then we'll automatically jump onto the position of principal plane, or the plane where shear stress is zero, right? Okay, so these are the two formulas, and now let me just start with position of principal planes. Now, first of all, you need to remember this. Principal plane is basically a plane where the value of shear stress is zero. A plane where sigma t is equal to zero will represent a principal plane. And there are two such planes. That means there are going to be two values of theta. And for a particular value of theta, there is going to be a major principal stress. And for a particular value of theta, there is going to be a minor principal stress. Maximum or minimum, you can also say. So let us just put this value is equal to zero. Sigma t has already been worked out. Let us just put this equal to zero and let's see what we get. So if we just try to do the math, this is going to precisely work out as, and let me just write this, tan 2 theta will be equal to 2 tau upon sigma x minus sigma phi. This is an extremely important result. And let me just write this P over here. P for principal planes, theta for principal planes. So there are going to be two values. I will come to that in just a short while. Now we are interested in, for this value of theta, we are interested in calculating the maximum and minimum values of normal stress, that is major and minor principal stress. How can that be worked out? Because this is very interesting. We don't have a unique value of theta, let's say 10 degrees, 20 degrees or anything like that. This is very complex. So in order to get out of this confusion, because if you want to find the maximum value of normal stress, you have to put the value of cos 2 theta and sin 2 theta in these terms. So how can that be essentially achieved? Well, that can be done with the help of trigonometry. So watch this triangle over here, and let's say this triangle is having an angle of 2 theta. If this is tan 2 theta, this is, by the way, 2 theta P, let's say. This is going to be perpendicular, this is base, opposite base. So this is 2 tau, and this has got to be sigma x minus sigma y. Even if you apply Pythagoras theorem, then this is square plus this is square, but under root. So whenever you put an under root, it has to be accompanied with a positive as well as a negative sign. So this is going to be very simple. Sigma x minus sigma y by, not by, square plus 2 tau. This is 4 tau square. Done. So there are going to be two scenarios which will generate. Scenario 1. Here, what you need to do is, you need to take this positive sign. Scenario 1, we are taking this positive sign. And when you do that, you can actually get the value of cos 2 theta for putting it up over here and calculating the principal stresses. So let's see, cos 2 theta will be equal to base by hypotenuse, base this by this, and sine 2 theta will be equal to 2 tau upon this. It's very simple. Okay, now let us try to put these two values in this equation, and then we are going to get a very unique value of normal stress, and that is what we'll call as the major principal stress. Let's try to do that. Okay, this was a real long expression. So what we've done is we punched in the value of cos 2 theta and sin 2 theta, taking the positive scenario onto this equation here and here, so that we are going to get a major maximum value of principal stress, right? Okay, let's try to solve this. How can we solve this? Is very, very confusing. Okay, what the best that we can do over here is this. Just leave this simply. Sigma x plus sigma y. Sigma x plus sigma y divided by 2. Plus, if you watch, these two are similar, right? So you can square them up, and even this bottom denominator is same. So let me just take that as common, and that's the stuff. Okay, that is sigma x minus sigma y whole square plus 4 tau square, and there you go. Okay, this 2 will be here, and this is going to become sigma x minus sigma y, these two are going to square plus. So what we've basically done is we have taken the LCM. If you have taken the LCM, this will become 2 will transfer over here. This is going to become 4 tau square. So this is pretty much the same expression, same thing. So this is like x over root x. So when you have to do x over root x, this is going to be equal to root x. Simple. Okay, so there you go. This is the final expression that we are going to get. Let me just rewrite this again. Okay, you can further simplify this. Let's say we want to shift this 2 inside the bracket, so it will square. This is going to become 4, and here also it goes. So 4 and 4 will cancel. This 4, the square of 2 is 4, so there is a much more simpler way of writing this. So finally, major, M-A-J, major principal stress can be written as sigma x plus sigma y by 2 plus 2 gets inside, and here we go. This is the bracket, sigma x minus sigma y by 2 square plus tau square. This is the final expression which you are going to get. Right? Again, one more thing. If you take this scenario 2, what will happen and how will the formula change? Let me just show that to you. I won't be doing this entire mathematics. Rather, these two values will become negative. So you have to put these two negative values into this equation, and the final value of minor principal stress, which you guys are going to get, is going to be equal to sigma x plus sigma y by 2. This is going to be accompanied with a negative sign, and that's it. The remaining stuff is same. Okay, so that's going to be sigma x minus sigma y by 2 square plus tau square. So this is the value of minor principal stress, or the minimum value of normal stress, you can say. Now let me write all of this in a very condensed form. Here we go. Now this is the best way to write this. For major, you have to take this positive sign, and for minor, you have to take this as the negative sign. Okay, one more thing which I was interested in telling you is about the angle theta p. Here we go. So guys, if you just take a look at this formula, we already wrote this tan 2 theta p. This is very interesting. So this actually worked out as 2 tau over sigma x minus sigma y. Let me just have a check. 2 tau over sigma x minus sigma y, isn't it? This can essentially be also be written as plus 2 tau over sigma x minus sigma y, okay, this both numerator and denominator positive, it can also be written as minus of 2 tau all divided by minus of sigma x minus y. It makes no difference to the balance of this equation. This both, this is whenever you do this tan perpendicular by base, let's say this is delta y, this over here is delta x, abscissa and ordinate, both of them are positive. So both of them are positive in the case of first quadrant, and here both of them are negative. That means negative, both of them are negative in the case of third quadrant. Even if you want to take a look at this from the graph, it would be something like this. Let me just make a plot. This is going to be sigma and this is going to be tau. So you've got two values, 2 tau and sigma x minus sigma y. So one point will be here like this, okay? So this is perpendicular by base, and this, by the way, is going to be an angle. I'm going to write that this is 2 tau and this over here is sigma x minus sigma y, okay? Apart from this, you will going to have one more angle, but in the third quadrant over here. And if you try to make a plot, it would be something like this. This is going to be 2 tau but with negative sign, and this over here is going to be sigma x minus sigma y again with a negative sign. If you have a careful look, this angle is 2 theta p1. As I told you, this theta p is going to have two roots. So one is going to be 2 theta p1, okay, and the other is going to be this 2 theta p2. So essentially you can say 2 theta p1 and 2 theta p2 are separated by, okay, separated by 180 degrees, separated by 180 degrees. So therefore you can conclude by saying that theta p1 and theta p2 are separated by 90 degrees. So finally the mathematical expression which you guys can write is theta p2 is equal to theta p1 plus 90 degrees, okay? So as I told you, there are going to be two principal planes for principal stresses. In one plane, you are going to get the value of major principal stress, and in the other, you are going to get the value of minor principal strains. And those two planes have been related mathematically with the help of this equations. You can see that, okay? So that's done. Theta p2 is equal to theta p1 plus 90 degrees. The position of principal planes are 90 degrees apart. As simple. So these are the conclusions which we can derive. The maximum, the major principal stress, positive sign, the minor principal stress, negative sign. So there are going to be two roots. As I told you, tan 2 theta p will have two roots, theta p2 and theta p1. These two angles represent the position of principal planes. And as you just saw, just a few seconds back, 2 theta p1 and 2 theta p2 were separated by an angle of 180 degrees. Therefore, theta p2 and theta p1 will be separated by an angle of 90 degrees. It's that simple, okay? Now let us take this session forward towards calculating the value of maximum shear stress. Okay, now how to approach this? Okay, so this is the final expression which we already know, okay? Something which we have already derived for any angle theta, this is the tangential stress. What we wish to find is the maximum value of the shear stress. And for finding any maximum value, you just need to differentiate it with respect to theta, let's say. For this, the variable is theta. So d by d theta of sigma t is going to be zero. So this differentiation is going to be very interesting. Watch. So this is going to be tau sigma x minus sigma y by 2 simply. And this is going to be sine 2 theta will become 2 cos 2 theta. Done. And this is minus of tau. Cos 2 theta will become minus 2 sine 2 theta, and all of this equal to 0. There you go. So we can write this also as sigma x minus sigma y and multiplied by cos 2 theta is equal to 2 tau, negative of 2 tau. It goes over, this becomes positive, and when it is transferred towards the right hand side, it becomes negative 2 tau sine 2 theta. Okay, now the theta that we are calculating is for the plane of maximum shear stress. Earlier the theta that we had calculated was for the plane of principal plane, or the plane where shear stress is zero. There is a difference, okay? So instead, what now we can do is, now this is fairly simple. Let's say we multiply both sides by negative. In that case, what would happen is this will become sigma y minus sigma x okay, and this is going to be cos 2 theta. This will become positive, that is 2 tau sine 2 theta, 2 tau sine 2 theta. Now the stuff is very easy. You just need to write this tan 2 theta is equal to, tan 2 theta is equal to this much, tau sigma x minus sigma y minus sigma x whole divided by 2 tau. So that is the entire mathematics for this angle. Now this angle again is going to have two roots, and by the way, this is the plane of maximum shear stress. So let's say we are writing a subscript s in order to differentiate between the earlier theta p and this theta s. Okay, maximum shear stress. Okay, let me write this, let me rub all of this, and please keep on pausing the video in between and keep making notes. So from differentiating this with respect to theta, we have arrived at this final conclusion. Tan 2 theta s is equal to sigma y minus sigma x over 2 tau. Now again, we need to find the maximum value of shear stress. For that, we need sine 2 theta and we also need cos 2 theta. How are we going to approach this? Very interesting. So this again is going to have two roots. 2 theta s, or let's say theta s in general, is going to have two roots. Theta s 1 and theta s 2. And at the end of this entire stuff, you'll realize that the maximum shear stress obtained on both the planes will work out as, numerically it will work out as same. The magnitude will be same. Although the sign may be different. One is going to be positive, one is going to be negative. So one is going to be the active shear stress, while the other is going to be the complementary shear stress. You will realize that at the end. Okay, so let's try to again do the same funda. Make a triangle here. This is going to be 2 theta. This over here is sigma y minus sigma x, and that's 2 tau. Obviously, using Pythagoras theorem, you shall realize this is going to be plus minus sigma, this is going to be 4 tau square plus sigma y minus sigma x times of whole square. Done. You just need to put the value of sine 2 theta and cos 2 theta. Again, there are going to be two scenarios. So first of all, let me take the positive scenario. Scenario 1. What? Positive. So let's try to do this. Sigma max, you are going to get the maximum value. Sigma max is equal to sigma x minus sigma y by 2. Let's write this. Sigma x minus sigma y by 2. Okay. Dot sine 2 theta. Sine 2 theta. So if you take a careful look, sine 2 theta. This over this. Perpendicular by hypo. Sigma y minus sigma x. Sigma y minus sigma x. All of this divided by this 4 tau square. Let me just write it this way. Sigma y minus sigma x whole square plus 4 tau square. Done. Okay. Anything else? Minus tau cos 2 theta. So there is no space. Minus tau into cos 2 theta. That is going to be base over hypo. That is 2 tau. 2 tau over hypotenuse. This. Sigma y minus sigma x whole square plus 4 tau square. Now we need to simplify this. Now what? We have to play very smartly. Okay. So watch this. If you take the LCM. So the stuff in the denominator will be this. This is going to be sigma y minus sigma x whole square plus 4 tau square. So now just take a look at this. This is sigma x minus sigma y minus sigma x. So what I have done is I have taken minus 1 as common. So sigma y minus sigma x. These two will become like this. This is going to be negative, and this is sigma y minus sigma x whole square. Again, minus, and once you have taken the LCM, 2 and 2 will multiply. This is going to be 4 tau square. Right? That's it. Now what you can do is, this is almost done. Almost done. It also, when you took the LCM, this 2 will also be there. Okay. And now, let me write this simply as minus 1 by 2, minus 1 by 2. And inside the bracket, you are going to have this. And finally, the expression that you are going to get. So instead of this sigma, let me just write tau max, the maximum shear stress, which you are going to get will be equal to minus of 1 by 2, same stuff, Okay, this is x by root x, which is equal to root x, root over sigma y minus sigma x whole square minus 4 tau square. This is finally the expression which we are going to be getting. Okay, one more thing. Let me just write this in a much more simpler fashion. You see over here that we have a negative sign. So if you want to shift this 2 inside the bracket, it will become 4. So 4 can be made 2 as a square, and then this 4 and 4 will cancel out. So the final expression for sigma tau max is going to be like this. Tau max is equal to minus 1 by 2 under root sigma y minus sigma x divided by 2 whole square plus tau square. That's it. If you take scenario 2 into consideration, let's say you do this 2 and scenario 2 and you take the negative sign, entire stuff will be same, even the numerical values will be same. The only difference is you will get a positive sign. Okay, so don't worry, it's one and same. Try to do that. So that's it. This is the maximum value of shear stress. That's the best way to write. Okay, and instead of putting a negative sign over here, let me just say magnitude wise or numerically it is equal to this much, right? One is going to be negative and other is going to be positive. The positive value that you have got is because of the complementary shear stress, and the negative value was active shear stress. That's it. Okay, now let us talk about the angle that we achieved. So this was tan 2 theta s, isn't it? And this was equal to what? Sigma y minus sigma x over 2 tau. Okay, now this is going to obviously have two roots, one theta s1, other is theta s2. So there are two planes where you are going to get the maximum value of shear stress. One is going to be positive and one is going to be negative. That's it. Active and complementary shear stress. That's it. No difference. Now take a careful look at this equation. This can be written in two ways. Tan 2 theta s is equal to, you just take the negative outside, minus of sigma x minus sigma y divided by 2 tau. That means numerator is negative and denominator is positive. You can do it in the other way also. How you can write this is, you shift this negative below and positive above. It can be done very easily. Okay, in that case, this is going to become sigma x minus sigma y. This is going to be positive and this will turn out as negative. It makes no difference to the balance of the equation. Now, this is, by the way, this is x and this is y. This is x and this is y. So you've got a quadrant system. Okay, let's first of all talk about this. X is positive and y is negative. So x is positive and y is negative. It lies in the fourth quadrant. Again, secondly, this y is positive and x is negative. This lies in the second quadrant. It's a clear-cut case like this. Again, one angle, or the two angles, that is 2 theta s1 and 2 theta s2, will be separated by a distance of, or by an angle of 180 degrees. If that is so, then let's write this theta s1 and theta s2. These are the planes of maximum shear, first of all. Planes of maximum shear. Okay, and from this analogy you can say, if 2 theta s1 and 2 theta s2 are separated by 180 degrees, then theta s1 and theta s2 will be separated by 90 degrees, right? And that can be written in this fashion. Theta s2 is equal to theta s1 plus 90 degrees. Very easy. Okay, now there is one final thing in this entire expression, and that is a sort of relation between the position of principal plane and the position of maximum shear. So the position of principal plane was obtained by using this equation tan 2 theta p. Principal plane is where the shear stress is zero. So when you equated this equal to zero, you got that. Tan 2 theta p actually worked out as 2 tau over sigma x minus sigma y. Right? Very important. Secondly, when we actually discussed the position of, not position, but the value of maximum shear stress. Okay, when we had to work out the value of maximum shear stress, that is this, we actually differentiated this expression with respect to theta. And finally, we had an expression like this. This worked out as sigma y minus sigma x over 2 tau. Now, let's say this is equation 1 and this is equation 2. If you multiply equation 1 with equation 2, there is a very, very interesting result which actually comes into the picture. And it's like this, tan 2 theta p, okay, for principal plane, S is for maximum shear plane. Tan 2 theta p dot tan 2 theta s. If you watch carefully, sigma y minus x, sigma x minus y. So there is going to be negative 1. 2 tau and 2 tau will cancel. If you just do this multiplication, this is going to work out as minus 1. This is very interesting. Do we get a result like this in coordinate geometry? Yes, we do. Let's say if you have having two lines. Line 1, let's say, is having a slope m1 and line 2 is having a slope of m2. And if, by the way, the slopes m1 and m2, the product of those slopes work out as minus 1, then we say that both lines are perpendicular, isn't it? And this is the same analogy which we are going to apply over here. That means, and this clearly means that 2 theta p and 2 theta s, the difference of angle in between them is 90 degrees. So if between 2 theta p and 2 theta s the difference is 90 degrees, then in case of theta p and theta s, the difference has got to be 45 degrees. So that's it. The final relationship, let me just write this. Theta s is equal to theta p plus 45 degrees. So this is the final relationship. So guys, the video has become very, very long and these are the final results. Okay, let me just summarize all of them for you. So you've got sigma n and sigma t, sigma n and sigma t onto this plane at an angle of theta. That's it, sigma n and sigma t. Then we worked on the finding the position of principal plane. So principal plane is where the value of shear stress is zero. So you just put this value of shear stress is equal to zero and you reach at this conclusion, 2 tau upon sigma x minus sigma y. Okay, and then we did the entire trigonometry thing. We also worked out the value of major principal and minor principal stress. That's the way to do it. Once you take the positive value and once you take the negative value. So when you take the positive value, you get this sign in between. When you take the negative value, you get, say, this sign in between. Okay, then we thought about working out the roots of theta p. So if you watch this, this 2 theta p is going to have two roots, theta p1 and theta p2, position of principal plane. On one principal plane, you are going to get the major principal stress. On the other principal plane, you are going to get the minor principal stress. That's it. And this is the relation in between the two principal planes. In the same fashion, we also worked out the maximum shear stress. So we want to find the maximum value of this sigma t. How can that be achieved? Well, the maximum value of any function can be achieved by differentiating it. And here the variable is theta. So differentiating with respect to theta and equating it to zero. When you do that, you get this final expression. Now, again, that we have to follow the trigonometry thing and we have to take once the positive value and once the negative value. When you take the positive value, you are going to get over here a negative sign. And when you do the negative value, when you put the negative value over here, you get a positive sign. But numerically and magnitude wise, the values that we've got is same. So one is the active shear stress and other one is complementary shear stress. That's it. And we also saw on differentiating this expression, we had this, okay? So this is, there are going to be two planes of shear, right? So theta s1 and theta s2. And this is where I've written that these are the two planes of maximum shear and they are separated by 90 degrees. That's it. And then with the final call, the relationship between position of principal plane and plane of maximum shear. That's it. Okay, simple, a bit of coordinate geometry I have incorporated in this expression. There you go. So guys, that was all from my side for today. I'll see you again in the next video. Until then, take care, have a nice day and keep learning. Thanks.